Okay. So something that we have tried to do the entire time that Councilman Nirenberg has been in office is to create a dialogue with the community. District 8, how many of y'all have been to one of our District 8 dialogues that we've had around the community? Great monthly event. So what we want to do is we want to create a conversation. We want to create a dialogue. So rather than, you know, just sort of doing an address, what we wanted to do was bring the community in, get your concerns, get your feedback, whatever that may be. So I just wanted to welcome you with that. And now we have to thank a few folks who are here in the room. Today we have with us our city manager, Sheryl Sculley. Our police chief, William McManus, is here. Our city clerk, Leticia Vasek. Right here. A proud District 8 resident right there. And then we also wanted to thank all of the other representatives of different city departments. If you have any questions about any of your city services, they're here to help. So let's just thank them for being here, for being a part of this event. This event was sponsored by a few partners here in District 8. So we need to thank USAA, IBC Bank, the Asian Chamber of Commerce, and the Alamo Area Chamber of Commerce. So let's give them a round of applause. And last but not least, I wanted to thank, in case you all didn't know, this is also being webcast so that we can expand it to a greater access. You know, more people hopefully will be able to see this conversation that we're having here. So we wanted to thank Nowcast SA for webcasting this out and for all the work that they do in San Antonio. And now I would like to welcome to the stage Bo Gilbert, who is going to introduce our one of our speakers for today. So let's welcome him to the stage.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon and welcome. First of all, I'd like to thank Councilman Nirenberg. This is a great idea, allowing you all to come here to express your thoughts, your questions, and for him to not only hear from you, but also to share his vision for the district. So I think this is a wonderful idea, and I appreciate the councilman for doing this. Thank you, Councilman. I have the pleasure of introducing Sheryl Sculley. Sheryl Sculley has been serving the city manager of San Antonio since November of 2005, when she came to San Antonio, bringing with her more than 30 years of public management experience. As city manager, she is the chief executive officer of the Municipal Corporation of 11,300 employees, an annual operating and capital budget of $2.3 billion, and a city population of 1.3 million residents. San Antonio is actually the seventh largest city in the United States. She has successfully balanced a city budget, including lowering city property taxes, increasing financial reserves, while substantially reducing waste. At the same time, she increased police, fire, and emergency responder services. Under her financial leadership, in 2008, the city's general obligation bond rating was upgraded by Standard & Poor's to a AAA, a first for the city of San Antonio. And if that wasn't enough, since 2010, she has enabled the city to achieve a AAA rating from all three AAA agencies. And as an example, this is the only, one of the 10 largest cities in the United States. She is the only city to have a AAA rating from all three rating agencies. Thank you. A little bit about her experience. Prior to coming to San Antonio, she spent 16 years in the city of Phoenix as an assistant city manager, and prior to that, she was in Kalamazoo, Michigan, where she was city manager for 15 years. In addition to working for the city, she's also one who dedicates her time to charitable organizations. She has participated in volunteer and city management organizations. She served on the San Antonio United Way Board, and in fact, she was also the chair of the 2013 United Way. She served on the Greater Phoenix Economic Council Board of Directors and the Executive Committee for 10 years, and is a life trustee of the Heard Museum. And if that's not enough, she has also led fundraising efforts for the education of single mothers, victims of domestic violence, and research for autism. When she's not serving the city as city manager, she's also adjunct professor with the LBJ School for Public Affairs at the University of Texas in Austin. She has taught graduate studies in urban studies, as well as mentoring our future leaders. Our city manager earned a bachelor's degree from Ball State University and a master of public administration from Western Michigan University. She's also completed the program for senior executives in state and local government at Harvard University's John F. Kennedy School of Government. Please join me in welcoming our incredible city manager, Sheryl Sculley.
Good afternoon. It is great to be with you out here in District 8. And isn't this a fabulous facility funded through our bond program? My gosh. And so all of you, we all voted for this great project to be able to add these more than 300 acres to our park system and have this wonderful, glorious day to enjoy the park. But this Ecology Center is just phenomenal. And I'm glad that there are so many people here this afternoon. I want to thank Councilman Nirenberg for inviting me to come out here. I'll tell you, he asked me to speak about city growth, innovation, finance, some of our bond projects, all in a few minutes. So I will be brief because I know you want to get to your table discussions. And as was said, we have quite a few city staff here today that will help us if you have a question about city point or issue. In fact, I'd like to ask all of our city staff, our department directors, and other staff who are here today to stand or wave. We have some officers over here to my left that are also here. Please recognize them for being here this afternoon. Public safety, our planning, development services department, solid waste, capital construction, code enforcement. A number of those key services are represented here this afternoon, so if you have some questions, we're happy to help you out. Well, first, let's just talk for a moment about the growth in the city, because I know that is an issue for District 8, and it's very important to the council member as well. We are now one of, if not the fastest growing city in the country, and with that comes a lot of challenges. Increasing population, more people to serve, more calls for service, and the need to do more in terms of our streets, our parks, our libraries, our health and human services, public safety. And so to address that, we have to constantly be innovative. But let's just look at just some of the numbers as we're beginning this conversation this afternoon about dealing with some of the challenges of growth. The 2010 census found 1.35 million determined that within the city limits. And of course, we know there's 1.7 million in Bexar County. So we represent the majority. The city has been growing by an estimated amount of 25,000 per year. And a current population of already, since that 2010 census, of 1,425,000. Bexar County is growing by 40,000 people per year. So by 2024, or in 10 years from now, the city's population is estimated to be 1.7 million people. And our Metropolitan Planning Organization estimates that if the recent growth rates continue, the city's population will surpass 2.4 million by 2040. So over 2 million people. Job rates are commensurate with that population growth are expected. So we know that that will present additional challenges to us as well with regard to our environment, to transportation, to water, and I know the council member will talk about that a little bit later. So lots of issues. So as a city organization, and my responsibility is to assemble a talented team that can deliver those services and bring best value to the dollar that you pay for those services through your sales tax, through your city property tax, through the rates that you pay for CPS Energy, since we own the energy company, and they pay to the city a payment in lieu of taxes, and a return on the shareholders' ownership. And we, as residents of the community, are those shareholders. And so the payment they make to the city is, in response, what they would be paying if they were a private company, as is the case in most other cities. So we use those revenues to bring you the best value. And we try to do that constantly, and we're always looking for ways that we can do it better. Over the past 8 years, we've actually reduced expense by more than $88 million. We found new, better, creative ways to deliver different types of services using technology, streamlining operations, eliminating duplication, automating in some cases. So we're constantly looking at ways, and we have an innovations group that every year is studying different business operations of the city to determine how we can straighten those pipes that get kinks in them along the way because we add additional rules or requirements in the process, not realizing that all of those compounded over time create more bureaucracy and make it more difficult to deliver that service or make it more complicated for you to obtain the service as well. So every year, we're looking at different aspects of the organization and then going back through it again to see how can we reset, do it a little bit better each and every year. We're required by state law to maintain a balanced budget. Our budget is balanced today. It's balanced when it's adopted by the council, and we follow our city finances very carefully throughout the year. I meet with our chief financial officer, many of our department heads, my budget director, at least monthly. I think they would probably tell you I meet with them weekly, which is often the case, to keep track of our income and expense, to make sure that we're properly following the trends of our revenues as well as how we're managing our expenses, to make sure that departments are staying within their budget and then adjusting our activities along the way to make sure that we are. So when we hear about a AAA bond rating, and some of you may be thinking, so what's the big deal about that? Well, right now I want you to know that as the financial markets have more and more pressure and it gets more and more difficult to achieve a AAA bond rating, we are now of the top 10 largest cities in the country, New York, Chicago, LA, Houston, Philadelphia, Phoenix. Among those top 10 cities, we're the only city to even have a AAA rating. And what that means is that it's a 10-point scale, and we have the highest rating, so we're able to achieve the lowest interest rates when we borrow money to pay for our capital improvements. And when we as voters vote on that capital improvement program with all of those projects, we then issue debt each year to pay for those and service that debt with our current city property tax rate. Well, when we have, of course, a low interest rate, it's just like the mortgage on your home. When you're paying less, then you have more disposable income. So we try to keep those interest rates as very low as possible. And let me just share a couple of numbers with you that we shared with the council this week. If we were downgraded from a AAA, just two notches, to a AA minus, a drop of three levels, we would save, it would cost us more than $38 to $44 million more just based on our current debt today. So as Councilman Nirenberg said, gosh, that's the entire Hausman Road project. Some of you know that the drainage and road improvements in total cost $43 million in our bond program from 1604 all the way to I-10, our Hausman Road. So we have in the bond program $43 million. That wouldn't be able to be there because we'd be paying interest. I just use it to give you a relative example of what that means to have a high bond rating so that you pay less in interest costs. So for the community, what it means to us is making sure as managers and stewards of your public monies is to do the very best that we can to bring the best value, to properly manage the finances, and to present to our elected officials alternatives and options on how to go about undertaking important projects. Now, some of you know, because I see many of you in the audience who served on and attended many of our bond meetings with the citizen groups to develop the projects that were considered in the 07 bond program, this park being one of them, and then the 2012 bond program. So in total, from the total city perspective, most of the money in our bond programs is going for streets and drainage projects, the most important things in terms of our infrastructure. $337 million in street projects throughout the city, $128 million in drainage projects, And then we have another little over $100 million in parks and libraries. And we also have some public safety improvements, three projects. So the majority of our funding in terms of our bond programs going into streets and drainage. Let me just mention a couple that are included for the 2012 bond program that are in District 8. UTSA Boulevard, it's a $16 million project, and we're able to leverage some Metropolitan Planning Organization money that flows to this region from the state, leverage our dollars to get more dollars through the MPO. So this project will reconstruct the roadway from Babcock to Edward E. Menace, and it expands from 2 lanes to 4 lanes, and it will be completed in the summer of 2016. Houseman Road, we all are familiar with that. We've teamed up and asked the county to partner with us on that project because they were going to replace 3 bridges just west of I-10 as part of their responsibilities. So with their $18 million coupled with our $43 million, that's a total project of $61 million. That is a tough project. And it'll be painful during construction, but when it's completed, it will construct Houseman from I-10 all the way to Loop 1604. This will also help UTSA. Albert's here this afternoon from UTSA. You'll recall in the 07 bond project, we partnered with UTSA on some of the sport facilities there to help the university and also make them available for the community. So Houseman will be the 4-lane roadway, and it will also have a hike and bike trail, bike lanes, and address the drainage issues along that corridor as well. The project will be completed December of 2015. Now I've challenged our construction group, and Rozzy's here this afternoon from Transportation and Capital Improvements, to keep two-way traffic maintained at all times. So we're trying something new in the last couple of years where we are requiring our contractors to work 6 days a week, sun up till sundown. If you drive by a project and you don't see a contractor out there working, you give this guy a call. I do that too. I go through our construction projects often. And I think we all don't mind if there's a lot of construction and disruption as long as we see people working. It's when nobody's out there that we're like, what the heck? You know, what's going on? This is an inconvenience for everyone. It's disruptive to business. So we're trying to get our contractors into a mode where they're working constantly whenever they have the weather to do it, which is most of the time until this winter. We've had a little trouble this year. And then with respect to fire station improvements, this area has had so much growth. You know that we've had a number of successful projects. Our Fire Station 51 that's located on Beckwith Boulevard, and that was a replacement. And when we build the new ones, we try to build them larger than what we need today so that we can grow into them, because our stations need to last 30 to 40. Some of our stations are 50 years old, so they have to last for a long time. Station 37, located on Vance Jackson, renovated as well, completed a couple of years ago. Also Station 34 that was renovated and completed a few years ago, Station 32. Then that project is slated for completion in 2016. And so we're constantly looking at, and as you can see, we have 51 fire stations throughout the community. So we have to work to maintain those and ensure that they're properly sized for today's equipment. And some of our older stations, we actually park the equipment outside because today's modern equipment doesn't fit in our old historic stations, which are great buildings, but not servicing what we need for today. So as you can see, there's so much going on within the city, and we have many, many challenges. But we're here to work with our elected officials to ensure that we're executing on the policies that they adopt, to help them with the options and alternatives that they can think through with you and with your input on how we best service the district and the entire city. And so some of what you'll hear about in the upcoming months, we're tackling a big policy issue right now with regard to legacy costs for both our civilian as well as our uniform personnel. We're a big organization. We employ almost 12,000 people. about 4,000 uniforms, 7,500 civilian employees. We're a $2.3 billion, very diverse municipal corporation. And so we have huge responsibilities as well as liabilities, and we're constantly looking at ways that we can do things better. And our conversation about legacy and healthcare is not about taking anything away from anyone who has accrued those benefits to date. So anything that's accrued, we're not talking about removing that. We're talking about how do we manage those costs in the future, and I know that the councilman has told me he's going to talk about that a little bit more later. So as you hear about this, and this does not affect in any way any line of duty in injuries. So if someone is injured in providing their job, we're not talking about taking away any of that benefit, but rather general health care for individuals and families and going forward. And what's the proper mix and how do we share in that expense? So you'll be hearing a lot more about that. But we're doing that with sensitivity. We highly respect, we highly regard our public safety personnel. They put their lives on the line each and every day. We're grateful for their service, and we appreciate all that they do. And I've been in this business a long time and have worked side by side with public safety personnel for, as you heard, more than three decades. And so I understand what it means to have public safety that are dedicated to that service. I attend their most joyous day when they graduate from the academies and are there with them, but I also go to the hospital with the chief when someone's injured in the line of duty and have to meet with the families when, heaven forbid, someone is killed in the line of duty. Those are tough things to do, so I know firsthand how difficult their jobs are. We also together need to work on how do we provide something that is reasonable, comparable, not out of line, and also affordable and sustainable for us for the long term. And that's the challenge. And sometimes that's in conflict, and yet we can work together to come up with a solution that makes sense for San Antonio. So that's what we're trying to do. Well, I appreciate, Councilman, you're allowing me to be here this afternoon, for inviting me, and also to see a lot of friendly faces that we've worked together on a number of projects over the years and in the past. I'll look forward to hearing some of the conversation yet this afternoon. Thank you for your attention, and thank you for your participation today.
Let's give another round of applause for our wonderful city manager, Sheryl Sculley. Welcome again to our State of the District event. District 8 residents always surprise me. I was a little bit worried that we were gonna have, empty chairs around the room. And here you are again. We're on a Saturday night in the afternoon during the rodeo, and we have over 100 people here to talk about municipal government. So thank y'all so much for coming out. Now, we are going to get the table discussion started, but I wanted to go over a few things first. You have sticky notes at your table, and what those are for is to address individual concerns that you may have, because we're going to try to keep the table conversations more district, focused on the whole district. And so if you have concerns, after we do the round table, we'll break for a little bit and you can post all of your concerns right up there. And so at your table, you should have one table leader and one scribe. And if you don't, you can figure that out amongst yourselves right now and just appoint one. And what they're to do is to guide the discussion based on the prompts and questions that are written on the table. And then the scribe is gonna write everything down. So after the discussion, each topic is discussed by two tables, and so we're gonna have corresponding table leaders meet, and you're gonna decide who's gonna report out to the group, and you're gonna outline your priorities on the easel between your table, and then we are gonna have a reporting out period to where we really outline our priorities as a district. And then after that, the councilman is going to give his address, and at the end of the event, or after the event, we are meeting at, if you want to, we're meeting at Freetail Brewery around 6:45. And so that being said, let's get the table discussion started. Some tables already have appointed table leaders and some might not. And we will have staff roaming around if you have any questions. And the city staff is also here to act as a resource in case you have any specific questions about public safety or infrastructure or anything else. So thank y'all so much.
We are going to start the reporting out period at this time, so everybody should have already picked someone who is going to speak. Just give us a quick rundown, quick being the operative word, of just sort of very briefly the broad stroke priorities that your group came up with. I think we've had some great discussions here today, and just know, and this is important, just know that none of this is going to be lost. So any notes that you have, any stickies that you write, anything that's on these boards, we are going to save, we are going to compile, nothing's lost. So if you have anything else that you want to contribute to the discussion, you know, feel free to do so. Okay, so we are going to go ahead and start right over here with the Quality of Life group, and if I don't move, then it's okay. All right. So we are going to have reporting out here from Dr. Yvonne Katz.
Thank you. I have to go really fast, so listen up. Libraries, yes. Electronic access to digitize all documents that are in the library that would be for research and database purposes. We need increased access to our libraries, more scheduled events, including children. We need to protect the books, you know what age group that is from. And we want to embrace infoscience, that is providing research, etc. Greenway space, yes, affordable way to keep people healthy. Find more sources for funding, and we might have to look at going through the legislature to get some laws, current laws changed, or to ask for some new laws. Park safety, yes. More people using cell phones to take pictures of those who are doing bad things. So we would help the police out by taking those pictures and helping them that way. Lighting improvements are needed. That was throughout all of our park discussion. There could be a volunteer cadre of people to help keep parks safe to go through with some type of little identification outfits on. Better communication for safety out to the community through computers, the internet, TV, PSAs, etc. Use digital safety solutions like a cell phone app that some young person in this room could develop before we leave here today to use on the cell phones as we're out in our parks. Install emergency call phones out in all of our parks. Better security for parks that are open late at night, especially for the joggers, and put those park police on bikes. Wi-Fi, yes. Library beautification, yes. But do xeriscaping so that we don't have to water so much, cut, do curbing, and all of that. And digital library, yes. But let the county build the digital libraries like they have on Pleasanton Road. And we, the city, would continue to improve our current libraries. That's it, the end.
Excellent, excellent. And that was excellently swift from the quality of life folks. Now we are gonna have the smooth stylings of infrastructure.
Oh, and it's smooth, that's for sure. Okay, so some of the things we talked about in infrastructure, how do you feel about managed lanes? Well, it's a pretty fancy word for toll. So our question on, or our thoughts on managed lanes were, who controls it, how do we manage it, how can we keep those funds local, whatever funds are generated. If they're paid locally, why can't we keep them locally? Okay, so that was one of the things that we talked about there. Next question, thoroughfares, having the most traffic congestion, what can we do about it? Wurzbach Parkway. We understand that Ron Nirenberg was able to get a study going on the Wurzbach Parkway at the end right there. So we really appreciate that. That's going to give us a lot of good information. Huebner Road, maintenance on Huebner Road. The intersections along De Zavala, Prue, Houseman, those roads are definitely a question mark, and they can be difficult at times. One suggestion that came up in here also was in regards to how can the city annex things sooner so that you can control development and make sure that we're in front of traffic instead of behind traffic. So that was an idea that came out. Broadband. Everybody kind of looked at each other on this one and said, how does CPS have broadband? Well, our question on it was, we need more information, but then the second question was, does the city even use this broadband? If it's just sitting there, is the city buying services from AT&T or Time Warner or something like that when they've got their own broadband network? So that's really the question that we had there. Bridges and overpasses, we really couldn't think of any that were of concern to us. Existing bicycle lanes, some are good, some are bad. That's the best way you can put it. One idea was how to control parking in bicycle lanes, since there's no rules or regulations on vehicles parking in those bike lanes. CPS and SOS, we're going to go ahead and how about it? Okay, we're going to go ahead. How about if I stand right here? No? Okay. I will combine those two together to wrap this thing up. All right, CPS and SOS, we thought overall service quality, we thought that they were good organizations. There was some question about overstaffing. Obviously, they always get a lot of bad press about bonuses. That was also a question that came up. So we wanted to have a little more transparency, a little more understanding of what those things entailed, how they developed those bonuses, and a little more in the way of customer input on those, I think, would be really good. So some more transparency. We'd like to also see SAWS improve some of their customer outreach. You know, CPS has got a great website, SAWS, not so great. You know, so I think those were some things that we talked about there. So that's District 8 infrastructure.
Thank you, Team Infrastructure. Okay, now we are going to move right over here. And again, you got to be a little bit smooth with this. So, public safety.
Okay, on public safety, our first question was what metrics should we use to measure SAPD performance? We're good, we like the ones that we have currently. We also thought that providing a percentage of arrest result conviction would be good to have as a metric, as well as rate of recidivism. And lastly, the civilian complaints against officers, unfounded or correct. SA Fire Department, good what we have, and we added to measure measuring safe behavior and recognizing the officers for safe behavior. But what do we think about body cameras on police officers? Feels so weird when that happens. Protects both the officers and the civilians. We like it. Park safety, you all touched on this a little bit. Okay. Park safety, in addition to what you found, we came up with maybe something like bells in the park. So if you're in trouble, you can make some kind of a noisemaker as another idea. Signs to remind joggers and people to leave one earbud out and to remember to take their cell phone with them. Increased bike police, as they said. And then a mapping app through Google Maps, so that you could have a map of the park while you're jogging or walking. Panhandling, what should the city do to address? Take them to Haven for Hope. We've all said that. In Santa Monica, they have a voucher program that John told us about, and You can roll your window down and give them a voucher, which just they can only buy food and restaurant, grocery, bus, and no alcohol or cigarettes or anything. And then we also said that perhaps the person handing money to the panhandler should get a ticket, so that we're not enabling the panhandling. And lastly, what can the city do to prevent property crime? Require developers to put more lights in the new subdivisions, and perhaps the city to help with more lighting, and build up our citizens on patrol, incentivize neighborhoods to build up that program. And last, if the city could provide cameras and help with security. Some neighborhoods pay for their own security. Other neighborhoods may not be able to afford that. And that would result in less police calls having to go out for crime. That's public safety, District 8.
Thank you. And we do apologize about the mic situation, but of course we hope that it works when it's steadily right over there. So now we're going to move on to the growth group, growth and development, which I think we're all very interested in. So I'm going to hand this off.
Thank you. Growth and development in District 8, we were posed with several topics, the first of which was with regard to the aquifer protection solutions we should explore. We came up with better enforcement of those laws that are already in place, in addition to stronger laws with regard to green space. We also want maybe that the city can suggest user-friendly methods for development, for example, the lattice concrete parking so that the water does run off. Public awareness campaign, link the Camp Bullis mission to responsible growth and recharge zone and beyond. So partner with the military because they've done a really good job already. So the public awareness campaign to get the word out and contributing zone regulations. Moving on to our next topic is how can we improve code enforcement? We came up with one primary suggestion of expanded hours. Code enforcement works Monday through Friday, 8 to 5, and a lot of times that code enforcement is needed to see the infraction on possibly weekends or once the person who's causing that code enforcement infraction. So maybe flex hours or weekend coverage. And moving on, our third topic is there a problem with high frequency rental in your neighborhood? I'm sorry, I'm gonna move on because that's on the next page. What topics should we consider in the zoning process? Decisions should be based on quality of life, not only for the developer who's asking to be rezoned, but also for the neighbors. We are suggesting that they look to expand the notification radius because it's really quite tight as it is, and the neighbors are affected to a greater area. And we're suggesting that the public be heard over the developers. Well, we got applause. Okay, now I'm gonna come back to, is there a problem with high frequency rental in your neighborhood? What we've learned sitting at our table, one of our participants was aware of a website called Airbnb, and it is a website that people can go online and find a room in a private residence to rent for a night. So Airbnb's out there, folks, and it's starting to happen. Single family homes in our communities are investment properties, and they're renting these to college students. So you've got a three-bedroom house Two people can be in each of those bedrooms, so you've got six college students. That translates into six vehicles parked at that property, as well as odd hours in and out all the time. So we don't have any solutions for this, but we know that these things are happening. Check out Airbnb. We brought it up while we were sitting at the table. It's very interesting. And lastly, should we explore incentivizing the use of existing vacant buildings? The short answer is yes. Definitely. Let's encourage more diverse types of business and jobs. For example, let's bring in some highly skilled jobs, not only service industry. But if the land has a building on it, let's try and get it occupied rather than building something new.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. And lastly, we are going to have our group who is dealing with the city budget.
I'm reporting for our table, which is table 9, and then we also have table 10. But I'm only reporting on table 9. We discussed several subjects. And we start out with the NOD meeting that there's going to be a shortage. The budget shortage is going to be in 2020. And so we came up with some ideas about retirement programs and salaries, and discussed things like teacher salaries being so low and compared to these pretend policemen or something, and their salaries are so high. And like military salaries that have their retirement and they get discounts. So then we moved along to water supplies, and we're worried about the growth of the city. And so we started going after that to the downtown area, and how the downtown area has taken old buildings and putting them in and making it into a more savvy area. And hopefully that will draw new people, because we need to draw people from the college graduates, just keep them here in San Antonio, and have places like Rack Space, who is now bringing more people here. And we have outstanding people graduating from Trinity University and places like that, but they leave San Antonio. So we need to have that drawing these people here to San Antonio. Then we got into needed more information on the budget and the percentage of what goes to where, and the bond property. We need bond projects. We didn't have enough information to really discuss that. And we just got started talking about plastic bags, and we did come up with an idea that we think there should be a commuter, a ban. Yeah, at the grocery store, if you bring your own totes, you get to go through a more fast service through there. And so we would like that project to be looked at. And anyway, we ran out of time. We had a lot to discuss, and we'll give you number 10 here.
I think we've got them up here. For table number 10, we were talking about the city budget, and the items that we keyed on, which we feel are the most important items, are first of all drainage and roads, talking about getting insufficient funds, for example, Prue Road and Lock Hill Selma, and improving the roads in the medical center. There's a plan for touching some of the roads with resurfacing, and then there's a plan to redo some of these roads. And the difference, I believe, for retouching them was somewhere around $250,000, maybe $500,000 per mile, and just from memory, like $2.4 million per mile to redo them. But we need to maybe wait a little longer and redo more of the roads so that we have improved infrastructure. One of the items that we looked at and that we would consider as far as the budget goes is, in the future, preparing for council and mayor pay increases so that we can match the rest of the country, all the other cities that are already doing that in Texas. Accessible public transportation, right now too many of these lines are inconvenient and so people aren't using them, and we're losing revenue, possible revenue. Public pension program, minimum age, and means testing, and this was about someone hiring on at a late age and then being qualified for retirement, and the discussion was that perhaps that should be looked at a little more and maybe a little more commensurate with the time in service and age. Public libraries, another area. There's some talk about cutting funds for the libraries, and this is an area that several of us felt was very important to keep. We have new libraries, we have nice facilities, we need to keep them open, perhaps longer hours, and we need to make sure that we're budgeted for that. TxDOT maintenance reforms, there's some conversation about TxDOT turning over a lot of the care and maintenance for the roads to the city, and we feel that that's not something that you know, we should have to be responsible for, since it's not just people in the city that are driving on these roads. This is something that the state really needs to maintain and stay on top of. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so that was a fantastic discussion. Again, if you have any other notes that you wanted to share, we have several District 8 staff members here. If you're on District 8 staff, raise your hand. So if you want to share, just bring that to anybody around the room, and we will make sure that that is all compiled in the reporting out for this session. Now, we are going to begin. We're going to begin the second portion of this, which I'm sure everybody is very excited about. So without much further ado, I would like to introduce Mr. Eddie Aldrete from IBC Bank.
Well, thank you. Just wanted to say thank you for being here today. It's an important process, and we're proud to be sponsors of today's event because this is critical to the success of a community when people come together and express their issues and their concerns. When I think of Ron Nirenberg, I think of three things: leadership, vision, and dedication. Leadership, because leadership isn't defined by what you say, but by what you do. And he has been showing that since the day that he took office. He's shown that he's not afraid to roll up his sleeves and to tackle issues. Not just the issues that you've been talking about: streets and drainage and truck crime and traffic and transportation and infrastructure, but the other issues too. The ones that are tough, the ones that are complex, and even the ones that are controversial. And I think that's the sign of a true leader. Vision, because he's not just focused on today. He is looking at economic development, and he's a champion of job creation. And what do we need to do to bring companies here that was just talked about? Good companies bringing high-paying jobs to this community to provide those opportunity. But he's also looking at the long haul. What does it mean? The two words that I've heard in the past hour here are growth and sustainability. So he's asking the tough questions about our electric grid, about our 50-year water supply, and how do we help maintain the growth and sustainability over the long haul for this community? He's asking not just why, but why not, and how, and where, and when. Those are the types of questions that need to be asked on the City Council. Dedication, because he's here today on a Saturday afternoon with all of you, giving of his personal time to do what it takes to get the job done. This is a critical process. It's an important process, just like we had during SA 2020. going around the community when the consultant said, don't expect more than 1,000 people, and about 5,000 people across the city came out. I'm reminded of a quote from Plato that says, get involved in the governmental process or you shall be governed by those who do. By being here today, you are choosing to be masters of your own destiny. And you're doing that under the leadership of Councilman Nirenberg. The one thing that I admire most about him is he listens more than he talks. And that's what his job is here today. He's here to hear what you think, what you believe, what you're worried about, what keeps you up at night, what you're excited about, and what you think we should be doing more of, and what you think we should be doing less of. Because the one thing Ron Nirenberg knows is that as a community, we can't move forward unless we move together. That's why I'm proud and honored to introduce to you our City Councilman, Ron Nirenberg.
Wow, thank you, Eddie. Hopefully this will stay on when I'm talking. I also want to thank Eddie. He's been a pillar in this community for a long, long time, and it's a real privilege to be introduced by him. I want to thank USAA, of course, Bo Gilbert, and also IBC Bank for sponsoring the event and our chambers as well. It's a real privilege to be here in front of you, especially on a Saturday night. I think Noah's actually trying to crack a joke there at the beginning when he said it's a rodeo day. You're here Saturday evening. You could be doing other things, yet you're here talking about municipal government. So really appreciate that. So it is an honor to be here with you as your councilman and to tell you that District 8 is and will continue to be a place we are proud to call home, a place where no matter your age, your profession, your politics, or your religion, you will find families and businesses like yours finding quality, safety, and prosperity. On every measure, from demographics to socioeconomics, District 8 is a microcosm of the city, a place as diverse as can be found in Texas. According to the last census, we are 43% Hispanic, 42% Anglo, 6% African American, 7% Asian. We have areas of majority upper income and areas of majority lower income and all strata in between. We have a place of worship for every religion practiced in San Antonio. And we are growing twice as fast as the rest of the city, nearly 34%. Since the last census. In District 8, we have an opportunity to demonstrate that communities can come together despite their challenges and differences. We can demonstrate that local government still works for everyone, that as a community, we thrive because of our diversity, not in spite of it. So this evening, I want to thank you for joining your neighbors, sharing your priorities, and helping us set an agenda for 2014. Now, we will need your help to make it happen. Today I want to share with you how local government is working for you and how you can get involved. But first I'd like to acknowledge my two toughest constituents, my son Jonah and my wife Erica. I love you both. It's a personal challenge for me to inspire the same passion and respect for public servants in my son Jonah. And though he doesn't quite understand the details of what we do, he always aptly measures the success of my day by asking, did you make our world better? In the last 6 months, our team has been working around the clock to meet the standards set by past leaders of District 8, so I want to say thank you to my friend and former Councilwoman Bonnie Connor for being here. And we've been doing the vital work of managing community issues. When you have a pothole on your street, a stray dog in your neighborhood, or graffiti on your property, your city government is here to help. My District 8 office has a goal with no exceptions. Return every call, respond to every email and letter, and treat every neighbor like your own. And in District 8, every voice will be heard and every issue will be addressed. The challenges we face in District 8 are not ours to face alone, so my first responsibility as your councilman is to establish a capable and energetic team to respond to the specific and varied needs of our community. And I'm pleased to report that we've done just that. So Alice, Jackie, TJ, Eloy, Coda, Harjot, Chris, and Noah, please stand up and be recognized. A On behalf of my neighbors in this district, I want to thank you for your service. And these guys are working every day, every weekday and every weekend to keep District 8 a great place to live and to work. They are problem solvers and they are working tirelessly for you. And together we're working to make District 8 and our office more accessible, present, and relevant in our community. Since the summer, we've hosted a family picnic at Bonnie Connor Park, a back-to-school event at Brandeis High School, and a holiday party at the Firefighters Union Hall. We collected canned goods for the food bank during Thanksgiving, and we donated toys to Elf Louise, and we participated in charitable events to help bring disaster relief to the Philippines. This summer, we created the District 8 Community Academy, whose mission is proactive constituent services. If you can't come to our office will come to you. We organize volunteer block walks to let neighbors know about the issues that we're addressing in the city, and we're gathering teams for on-call graffiti abatement. We're adding to our District 8 Bandit Sign Brigade to remove the nuisance signs that bring down the appearance of our neighborhoods. Through the District 8 Community Academy, my office listens to our neighbors, identifies challenges, and solves issues together. Today, you've taken time to help organize priorities for our community, and I hope soon you will take time to attend one of our monthly D8 Dialogue Town Hall events, or join us on one of our citizen advisory councils that examine and advise my office on issues like energy policy, job creation, neighborhood safety, and many others. Boosting participation throughout the district, however, cannot happen without a corresponding commitment to increasing transparency. So my office is leveraging technology to bring government closer to you through every media, from public access to social media. And I'm excited to tell you that we're leading a charge with city staff to broadcast the Wednesday City Council B sessions. For local government junkies, like Marianne, for interested citizens, or those who just want to see more of Salon.com's 7 Sexiest Men, you're welcome. Every resident should have access and input on how we balance growth while maintaining quality of life that we want and expect. And as you know, in District 8, that growth is rapidly unfolding. This district is home to 3 Fortune 500 companies, a university in pursuit of Tier 1 status, the hub of our region's healthcare industry, and world-class shopping districts like the La Cantera and the Rim. We are an epicenter for economic development in the city, and as your councilman, I will push strategies that drive job creation, including conservative but effective use of incentives to bring businesses and retain existing ones here in our community. Return on investment is what matters. And that's why I'll push an agenda that prioritizes job training and workforce development, small business opportunities, and business incubators like that can be found here in the district in biotech and medical research. Job creation and workforce development is absolutely vital for our future here and throughout the city. The challenge of growth is that often it is occurring faster than infrastructure can keep pace. Balance comes at a higher and higher premium. I push for an approach in zoning, planning, and economic development that is pro-growth, but protects cost of living and quality of life. This means making the right investments in infrastructure and working with businesses and residents to anticipate and to mitigate the impacts of new development. Balance achieves the outcomes our community needs: new jobs, broad economic impact, quality neighborhoods, and respect for our natural resources. This pertains to industrial, commercial, single-family, and multifamily projects, and it means we will work with businesses to achieve quality development, observant of the fact that private property carries inherent rights for the owner and obligations to be a good neighbor in the community. In every case, we'll work with stakeholders to mitigate impacts, including aesthetics, safety, environment, and traffic, and so far, we've done exactly that. On the top of everyone's list of growth issues to address in the city, however, and certainly here in District 8, is traffic. If you spend any time on Wurzbach, De Zavala, Prue, Hausman, or most any other road that goes east-west in District 8, you know that traffic is a strike against us on this side of town. 2 years ago, I sought this office in part because I wanted to do something about our growing traffic problem, and today I am. Recently, I was appointed to the Metropolitan Planning Organization, where we work with officials in surrounding counties, the city, and the Regional Mobility Authority, John Clamp is here, and TxDOT to secure federal and state funding for improving traffic across our region. Just last month, transportation officials joined together to announce investments in local road infrastructure that total $825 million. As a result, we will be conducting a thorough study of the Wurzbach Corridor, which will soon take freeway traffic right into the heart of residential congestion around the medical center. I hope that solutions presented that in this study can be applied to other problem areas throughout our district, hotspots like Prue Road, De Zavala, Huebner, and Babcock. We will be constructing managed lanes on I-10 between 1604 and Ralph Fair Road. These new lanes will provide guaranteed uncongested priority travel for mass transit and emergency vehicles, and provide a revenue source for construction and maintenance and consumer choice for private commuters. We are revising the infrastructure maintenance program to identify streets that have been mired in disrepair far too long. And I'm collaborating with colleagues in neighboring districts to help improve intersections and traffic flow on streets that we share. And I'm working with engineers at the city and in private practice to identify creative solutions to the most vexing residential bottlenecks that slow down your commute to work. The unfortunate reality, however, is that it will take bond-sized, multi-million dollar projects to truly make significant progress for many of our district roadways. And over the coming years, as we look toward the next bond program for the city in 2017, I'm asking you to help identify our region's most critical infrastructure needs. That process needs to start today. This will take collaboration among you in this room to help prioritize limited resources on seemingly unlimited infrastructure need throughout our district. When we work together to set priorities, it allows us to focus our efforts and resources to make effective, long-lasting improvements rather than spreading resources too thin and ending up with a lot of change, but not a lot of improvement. A good model of how we've done things right and differently than in the past is right here in District 8. The marquee project in the 2012 bond project is the roadway and drainage improvement on Hausman Road. At a total cost of $62 million, the Hausman Road project is the single largest voter-approved roadway improvement in city history. I want to thank my predecessor, former Councilman Reed Williams, for demonstrating leadership on this and for being my guest at the groundbreaking in December. Despite the enormity of the project, Hausman will be complete on a much shorter timeline than conventional construction. And it will include roadway expansion, dedicated turn lanes, hike and bike trails, and new utility and drainage infrastructure. But with this one massive project, we are making significant progress to address east-west connectivity throughout our district. And if we do things right, we can celebrate more groundbreakings just like this one in the coming years. It's important to note, however, that Hausman Road would never have gotten done without the approval of voters, and were it not for the success of the city's financial management. We recently learned that not only is San Antonio the only big city in the country with a AAA rating from all three credit rating agencies, it is the only top 10 city with a AAA rating from any agency. This is not merely window dressing for our city. For instance, as the city manager said, a two-notch decline in rating for San Antonio would have increased borrowing costs by the same amount as the entire road construction of Hausman. Were it not for San Antonio's strong financial position, a road like Hausman would be remaining undone for years. No bike lanes, no bridges, not one square inch of asphalt on one of the most congested roadways in the city. However, this year we learned that new criteria by rating agencies have put San Antonio on notice, and we must respond. That is why in the coming year I will be advocating for an increase in saving to reserve funds. This is a starting place. And with ever-stretched revenues, it will likely mean additional tough choices during our budget talks this summer. On my fifth day on this job, council met and was told that San Antonio faced a $35 million shortfall in fiscal year 2014. We made some tough choices and we delayed others, and we will face similar challenges in 2015. And though one-time fee increases and efficiency measures help ease the pain of core service cuts, they don't stop the bleeding of an overall structural budget deficit. We must address the fact that despite cuts in services over the past several years, growth in revenues is not keeping pace with growth of expenses. And as a community, we must engage the difficult conversation of which core services we are willing to live without and which taxes and fees we are willing to pay. One thing I learned in the fiscal year 14 budget process was the importance of reforming how we fund social service agencies. We currently have a pool of $22 million in the Department of Human Services that goes to roughly 60 delegate agencies performing a host of services, from homelessness prevention and transformation to AIDS prevention. Rather than offer a strategic direction for the city, the current system encourages agencies to lobby council for funding. It's demeaning to the agencies themselves and often results in duplication of services paid for by taxpayers. In response, we are pursuing improvements to an anti-lobbying policy that can add procedural integrity and efficiency to the process. We are well on our way to achieving those goals. And in addition, I believe that we can examine how city-owned properties are leased to third-party businesses and organizations. There are good reasons to provide below-market rate leases to quality organizations, especially those that provide important services to the public. However, so-called dollar leases are revenue lost for the city at a time when residents are being asked to pay more for less. And we should consider adjusting those dollar leases so that good organizations still save money for delivering good services, but they are also paying a fair rent. Fairness is an important concept, and this will drive one of the most important conversations for the future of San Antonio's budget: how to fund and deliver public safety in our community in the years to come. Every year, City Manager Sheryl Sculley reports to the council on the city's finances. We prioritize based on that fiscal reality. Public safety is the first and most fundamental priority for the city and for most any governmental entity. As such, it takes up 2/3 of the city's budget in San Antonio. Crime has decreased overall, including violent crimes in District 8. And fire service has improved response times and flexibilities with additions to serve northern reaches of District 8, a mobile command unit, and specially trained firefighters who can respond quickly to crises, including brush fires. My office has worked with SAPD to identify hotspots for property crime, which has plagued District 8 neighborhoods for years. And we are working with SAPD to stop illegal street racing, a dangerous crime that has taken the lives of too many young people here in District 8. I have also pushed for the continued enhancement of our safe department operations that buoy neighborhood quality of life. This year, we mourn the loss of Lauren Bump, who was murdered in one of our parks. I want to thank the police department for acting quickly and for catching the suspect. Though this won't bring back Lauren, we will honor her memory by doing everything we can to deliver justice on this case and to work together to keep our park system safe for families to enjoy. Our park system is the crown jewel of this city, especially here in District 8, and we cannot allow it to be held hostage by crime or by fear. Park safety will be a high priority for my office in the coming year. With two premier public safety departments, we must work together to keep them that way. But as time wears on, old ways of funding public safety and honoring a commitment to our first responders have challenged the financial well-being of these departments nationwide. We have seen examples where unrealistic expectations and a refusal to work together have led to financial ruin of entire municipalities. That won't happen in San Antonio, because we won't let it happen in San Antonio. So the city has undertaken an effort to address increasing strain on a budget caused by medical costs that are rising 2 to 3 times faster than growth of revenues. Make no mistake, public safety officers deserve to be treated with respect and paid a fair wage with benefits to match. They put their lives on the line for us, not for the pay or the benefits, but because they are San Antonians who care about their neighbors too. I believe that the first and best way to keep first responders safe is to make sure public safety departments are fully staffed and fully equipped. We can't do that and meet our other core service obligations in the meantime without fiscal responsibility. We must make sure expenditures in any department don't get out of balance with the other important services that make San Antonio livable, such as libraries, streets, and parks. As the public safety operations and benefits are collectively bargained again this year, it will be important to note our fiscal reality. There is a structural budget deficit caused by rising costs that must be addressed. Temperance and realism in those negotiations are vital for everyone. In the end, I am confident that despite the temperature in the room, we will get this right as a community. I was reminded of that when I saw the thousands of residents lining the streets to pay tribute to fallen police officer Bobby Decker, as he was laid to rest earlier this year. He was a 31-year-old standout for this city, and his heroism left behind young children and a grieving widow. Yet, our community is safer because of him. Officer Deckard's sacrifice should be honored by all of us, and the four pillars of the department's vision, which Bobby upheld, should prevail: integrity, respect, compassion, and fairness. Our public safety mission is also advanced here in District 8 by one of the city's largest and most important assets, the South Texas Medical Center. It employs 26,000 workers and hosts more than 5 million patients annually. All told, the economic impact for San Antonio is some $30 billion annually. I want to thank our partners in the Medical Center, especially the San Antonio Medical Foundation, led by Jim Reed, who was here earlier, and the Medical Center Alliance, led by Bill Bouthrop. I'm working with both of them as they revise the area's strategic plan so that infrastructure investments by the city align with the Medical Center real estate and economic development activity, totaling in the billions over the next several years. Collaboration at this level will help us to realize an enormous opportunity for continued job creation in this sector. And while economic development at the Medical Center is important, ensuring that each employee, patient, and visitor travel safety is even more important. Since this summer, we have directed resources to street, sidewalk, and signage improvements. We have dropped the speed limit throughout the Medical Center, and we bolstered police presence to make sure drivers slow down. In December, we broke ground on a $6.6 million project that will improve Hamilton, Wolf, and Babcock, and the council approved $1 million for a project to improve the crosswalk and sidewalks at Merton Minter and Wurzbach. These projects leverage private funds and represent the quality collaboration that exists between the city and the medical center community, and that will continue on my watch. The medical center and medical industry centered here in District 8 is advanced further by worthy public and private investments in advanced technology, biosciences, cancer therapy, regenerative medicine, and research. The world will take notice of that in December as San Antonio hosts the 2014 World Stem Cell Summit. And I want to acknowledge the important efforts of Ann Stevens and Biomed SA, who have worked to bring that conference here and raise the profile of medical and biosciences in San Antonio. Our community of research and thought leaders in the medical community continues to grow, and it is no coincidence that there is a corresponding growth in the of the University of Texas at San Antonio in its pursuit of Tier 1 status. Already, UTSA confers more degrees than any other university in South Texas and contributes over $1 billion to the local economy. But like growth of the region in general, UTSA's growth has been accompanied by some pains, including a changing landscape nearby some of our well-established neighborhoods. On the front end, my office will continue to work with landowners and builders to ensure new developments are high quality and address the aesthetic, safety, traffic, and environmental concerns we all share. And on the back end, we are working with neighborhoods, with SAPD, area businesses, and students themselves to ensure that the character and quality of life in these areas is maintained. We are also meeting with UTSA officials to discuss their master plan. For a university of this size, in proximity to neighborhoods like these, we need a student cultural zone around the university that helps provide a place for student-friendly activities, but also protects against the erosion of family-friendly environment in adjacent neighborhoods and business corridors. I'm ready to work on this, and for the benefit of area residents, and for the benefit of current and prospective students. Encouraging good growth like this is what will make our city healthy and our economy strong. However, we need a more comprehensive discussion about the basic element of our economy, and the one that can either support positive growth, or hinder it. Water. Recently, the Dallas Federal Reserve Bank released a report that cited water scarcity as the biggest threat to the economy in Texas. Water is and always will be an economic issue for San Antonio. Our water supply comes primarily from the Edwards Aquifer, a quickly replenished, unfiltered underground source of water that is regulated by local, state, and federal laws. Yet with growth projections of our region and persistent drought conditions, the need to secure new supplies, protect current ones, and diversify the system overall has never been greater. It is clear that every action that we undertake at the city, from building of transportation infrastructure, to annexation, to a push forward on higher density residential communities, has an impact on the availability of water in our future, both for sustaining life and for sustaining economic well-being. This week, I filed a council consideration request directing city staff to assemble a report that compiles all of the policies, procedures, regulations, and standards that impact or are impacted by water supply, our ability to provide clean and abundant water for our future generations. I look forward to the dialogue that we will have with the entire community on this issue, and I'm hopeful that the result will be at this and future councils will be able to act at every level to enhance water security. It is an economic imperative. The challenges for water supply, transportation, education, job growth, and so many others are daunting And in District 8, the challenges are especially acute. However, my office is leading a charge to meet the demands of growth in San Antonio, to secure the quality of life you've come to expect, and help us build a San Antonio that we can be proud of. Today, I'm asking you to take part in these conversations beyond this room. Be a part of our office's efforts to improve our district. Help us push forward the agenda that we've built together. The next 2 years will be turbulent, at times controversial, but always moving forward. We are working to save the largest bat colony on Earth from encroaching development in the Hill Country. We are finding ways to provide more efficient services to refugees that are brought to this city and into the heart of our district. We are working to ensure that the explosive growth in Northwest San Antonio and throughout the city brings prosperity and bolsters quality of life. We are working hard for you and for your family. And while there will be debate, you can count on me to always ask three basic questions. Is it fair? Is it fiscally responsible? And have we done our homework? I thank you for the privilege to serve you and represent our many neighbors here in District 8. So now, let's get to work.